Thank you, everybody, for coming to the Aaron Torres Podcast YouTube page. I do have one quick favor before we get to the video that you came here for, and that is very simply this. You see that little red subscribe button below this video? Go ahead, smash that subscribe button. It really does help me. It really does help this channel grow and my audience grow. So go ahead and hit that red subscribe button. And now, here is the video that you came here for. But I do want to start with Nolan Hickman because this is mega news. And as a little bit of backstory, Nolan Hickman, again, five-star-ish, you know, kind of a fringe five-star point guard, had been committed to Kentucky really for about a year now. I mean, I don't remember the exact day that he committed, but basically sometime mid-pandemic, June, July, August, somewhere in there, decides to commit to Kentucky, has basically been committed to Kentucky for a year, and there was no reason to think that he was not committed to Kentucky until late Friday when he announced that he will be decommitting from the school. Now, normally, decommitments happen. It's part of the deal. This one jumped out for a few reasons. First of all, because Kentucky actually needs him. I mean, this is not the kind of case where maybe he was the fourth guard taken in a class and he kind of realized, like, hey, if I get to campus, I might not play. Kentucky has no point guards on its roster right now, which is why this is so big. Devin Askew, their starting point guard from last year, has transferred. He is now at Texas. Kentucky is actively recruiting the transfer portal. And so I don't think anybody, including John Calipari, expected this guy to be a starter next year and be like the point guard of the team. But I also, you know, they needed him as a backup, as a reserve. He was a kid that was going to play minutes. But then, two, the bigger story was, in addition to the fact they didn't have a point guard, is it came out of nowhere. And as soon as it happened, I think I had the same reaction that most of you did, was one of two things has to be true. One, either Kentucky has not only one transfer ready to commit, but possibly two. Is it possible that he got wind that they're just loading up in the transfer market and that because of it, he's not going to have a place? That was my first thought. And then my second thought, which I think also a lot of you thought, was, uh-oh, is this just another bad piece of news for Kentucky? And is this program just falling apart? Like, it is just possible that he decommitted, he watched the team last year, they stunk, and he said, I want nothing to do with it. But the reality is that it is actually neither. So the reason he decommitted, shout out to my buddy Jack Pilgrim. Maybe I'll get Jack Pilgrim on here in the next few weeks to kind of talk about what's going on with Kentucky. But shout out Jack Pilgrim because he got an interview with Nolan Hickman's dad, and a couple things stood out. First of all, he was really close with Tony Barbie, who was his lead recruiter. Tony Barbie has recently left Kentucky to take the Central Michigan head coaching job. So that was the first reason he left. Tony Barbie was his primary recruiter. Joel Justice was his secondary recruiter. Joel Justice has also left for another assistant coaching job. And so his two main points of contact basically are no longer at Kentucky. But then the bigger one, which I found very interesting, was that basically Nolan Hickman had a crappy year at high school because of all these COVID restrictions and basically said, I don't want to travel 3,000 miles across the country. I am from Seattle. I don't want to go all the way across the country and then potentially be locked up in my dorm room again. And so this is what his dad told Kentucky Sports Radio's Jack Pilgrim. This is why he decommitted. This is what you need to know. This is what the dad said. It was rough with COVID. You've got to be away from family again. COVID has played a part in people's lives way more than you think. I don't think we took into consideration that he was allowed to have a season, but me and his mom, we were in tune with our child, but we weren't as in tune as we needed to be. We sent him to Mount Pleasant, Utah. So this kid played high school ball in Utah, away from the city, friends, and family. FaceTime isn't enough. And then you go through stretches. Having a season almost hindered his growing and his capability of life. Anyway, it's a long quote, but this is essentially what you need to know. This kid is from Seattle. He went to prep school in Utah, and while he was allowed to play a season, essentially he spent the whole season in lockdown, right? No different than most of college basketball, where you go to the gym, you practice, you play a game, then you immediately go back to the dorm, you immediately quarantine. And this kid said he came home for the summer to get ready to go to Kentucky, and he said, Dad, man, I don't want to. I just spent a year isolated from everything and everyone I know. I don't want to go 3,000 miles away and do the same. And so while I know it's frustrating for Kentucky fans, I do hope you guys kind of understand, and I do hope, frankly, that there's a little bit of sympathy, because you know, what Nolan Hickman went through and what he's describing is what I think all of us went through at some point. Like, I can't criticize Nolan Hickman because I know myself I went through this. It's not funny, but it's interesting. I vividly remember when I read that quote, it took me back to, I forget if it was November, December, but we went through all of last year. I live in California, I think most of you know. Things were finally getting back to normal in September, October. World's kind of getting back to the way that it was. And then, bam, right around Thanksgiving, everything shut down again. Couldn't eat at restaurants, couldn't eat outside, couldn't do the basic things that we as humans want to do. And I vividly remember one day, out for a walk with my wife, just trying to get out of the house. And it was like 6 in the morning because we get up early and we get stuff done. In the Torres household, that's how we do things. But we're out for a walk. And I just remember saying to her, I said, sweetie, we gotta move. I can't do this anymore. I cannot live like, I don't want to use the word prisoner. I don't want to over-exaggerate it, but I can't live like a prisoner. I can't do this. I need to be able to sit outside and drink a beer and not be freaking harassed by the police. And she calmed me down. And like, honestly, it was just one of those moments where like, I was really upset. I was really frustrated. I was really tense. I don't know what the right word is. I wasn't like moving to Texas the next day or moving to Florida, but like I hit a wall where I was like, I cannot do this anymore. And so I can't blame Nolan Hickman as an 18-year-old kid for going through the exact same thing, for saying I was away for a year. It messed with my head being isolated, being locked up. And I don't want to go through that again. And so, yes, I do want to play closer to home. I do want to play closer to my mom and dad. I do want to play closer to family. And I don't want to have to be somewhere 3,000 miles away, especially now that my two lead recruiters are gone and I don't really know anybody over there. So I can't blame Nolan Hickman, and I do hope that most of you guys kind of understand at least where he's coming from. You don't have to like it. I understand the frustration, but I do understand where he's coming from. I also think in the bigger picture outside of Nolan Hickman, it'll be interesting to see where he ends up committing. But I think in the bigger picture, it is now a fascinating conversation as to what happens with Kentucky. Because as I said a minute ago, we are now a month away from Kentucky's players reporting right around June 1st. Most of college basketball, they're getting their kids back on campus for summer school on a normal schedule. That's right around post-Memorial Day. That is June. That is mid-June. That is late May, whatever it is. Kentucky's planning on having their kids back on campus on June 1, and they don't have a point guard right now. And so to me, this is the single biggest story in college basketball right now, is because you look across the rest of college basketball. Let's just use the SEC. Arkansas, their roster is mostly set. They might add a piece, but it's mostly set. Alabama, their roster, they're waiting for a guy or two to figure out their NBA draft stuff, but their roster is mostly set. Duke, their roster is set. North Carolina, their roster is set. Michigan, Michigan State, whoever. Kentucky does not have a point guard. And it's not as though there's a ton of great options left. And on top of that, I would also say, oh, by the way, you're currently down two assistant coaches who have both left for other jobs. And so if you're John Calipari, I'm just going to say it. I don't know if it's time to panic if you're a Kentucky fan, but it's definitely time to be like a little bit concerned, because we don't have a point guard. We need not only a point guard, but probably a backup point guard. And we're down two coaches to actually do it. I would also say, of course, and this is not a criticism to be abundantly clear, John Calipari's been off the radar with all the Terrence Clark stuff. And I get it. I don't blame John Calipari. He's a father figure to these kids. I don't blame him for not being worried about his point guard situation with the tragic news of last week. Again, to be abundantly clear, I am not blaming him. But what I am saying is he hasn't been able to be as hands-on as possible. Two of his assistant coaches just left. He only currently, as I record here, has one assistant coach, basically having to recruit the entire position. And I think it's going to be fascinating to see what happens going forward. Now, the good news is there are still some good options out there. Xavier Wheeler, the point guard from Georgia, it's kind of interesting. Right before I recorded, I noticed that he put out kind of a cryptic tweet that there's going to be something happening on Monday. Maybe he is the guy, and maybe by the time you guys listen to this, this is all null and void, and you have Xavier Wheeler. Marcus Carr is in the mix, but Marcus Carr is going to test his NBA draft prospects. Marcus Zagorowski is a name I heard. If he comes back to college, would he consider transferring? I'm just going to tell you, I have some pretty good sourcing on that. I don't think he's coming back to college. I have no reason to believe he's coming back to college based on the people that I've talked to around him. I think he is 2 feet in the NBA. His brother plays in the NBA. Once his brother's season ends, they're going to train together to prepare for the draft. And so I only bring it up because Kentucky's window to find a guy is narrowing very quickly. Now, the little bit of saving grace that there is, there's going to be more movement in the transfer portal. One, there's always the possibility that a Marcus Carr does say, hey, I'm just not ready for the NBA, or the NBA is not interested in me. Let me come back and ball out of Kentucky. Obviously, Ty Washington, the five-star kid out of Arizona, is in the middle of his recruitment. So there are options. And like I said, Sevier Wheeler could commit any day now. He is a great option if you can get him. And there are some other pieces that can help Kentucky as well. C.J. Frederick, the former Iowa player, he is set to transfer. It appears as though Kentucky is the team to beat. If that happens, he can be kind of a secondary, third ball handler if you need him. But I'm only bringing it up to say, if you're Kentucky, it is officially go time. And if you're a Kentucky fan, I understand your angst, your nervousness, your whatever, because we are now a month away. And you do not have an answer at point. You don't even have a point guard on your roster. So this will be the single biggest story to watch in college basketball going forward as Kentucky tries to figure out who its point guard is for the 2021-2022 year. And you're basically running out of time to do it. As soon as we get an update, I will obviously talk about it. If it is Sevier Wheeler, if we do get somebody else, if somebody else enters the portal, I'll let you know. But to me, this is the single biggest topic in college basketball.